Hello there, this is Jamie. Welcome to another session of Vista Export Services. In this particular session, I'll quickly show you how I was able to create this floor texture here. After a few requests to publish a tutorial on how I was able to create this floor surface, I've finally taken time to do it. Before we start, we need to download two plugins, the floor generator and the multi-texture procedural map, and some high-resolution wood plank textures. To find everything, simply Google cgsource.com. In their website, you can find all the plugins. In the plugins tool section, we have the floor generator there. We also have the multi-texture map and the wood boards to download. After downloading and unzipping everything, go into your programs folder where you've installed your version of 3ds Max. On the root of your plugins folder, simply copy and paste both the DLM and the DLT files. There's no need to install anything. To see the floor generator, simply restart your 3ds Max and draw a spline, followed by opening the modifier panel to choose the floor generator. The floor generator plugin works best with splines. As you can see, just by adding the floor generator modifier, it automatically creates the floor tiles for you. In the board size parameters, you can quickly set the max length and width. Before you start creating the floorboards, make sure you set the unit setup. In my case, because the grout and the bevel values are usually very small, I would normally set the display unit scale to millimeters to make it easier to type in. It's worth noting that the display unit scale is only for display purposes. You can easily tweak with the offset and the board size values to randomize the wood planks. You can also rotate the wood planks by simply typing in the direction value to about 90 degrees. The next step is to apply the multi-texture procedural map to the wood floor. Let's start by opening the Material Editor dialog first. Click on the standard toggle and choose the V-Ray shader from the browser list. Next, click on the diffuse toggle, scroll down the material browser and choose the multi-texture procedural map from the list. After loading up the multi-texture procedural map, click on the Manage Textures toggle. In the dialog, click on the Add Bitmap button to bring in the textures. This is one set of wood planks previously downloaded from the cgsource website. They all vary in patterns. Let's select the entire set. After loading up one set of textures, simply close the dialog box and assign it to the floor object. After assigning the material, enable the Show Shaded Material in Viewport button. Even though each bitmap differs from one another in the set, we can still randomize them further in the color adjustment group. I simply increase the random gamma value slightly and the distribution. Let's do a quick test render to see what the floor is looking like. The floor is looking okay. To make it more realistic, we're going to start by tweaking with the reflection and the glossiness settings. To have the full control of these settings, let's start by disabling the Fresnel reflections and unlocking the highlight glossiness values. To increase the reflectivity, simply click on the Reflect Color Swatch to bring up the Color Reflection dialog. Also, enable the Background toggle there. If you double-click on the Material slot, it allows you to see the amount of reflectivity they've got. So the reflections at the moment are very linear. It's almost like glass. To diffuse the reflections, simply reduce the reflection glossiness values slightly. To add specular highlights on the surface, simply reduce the highlight glossiness value slightly. The smaller the values, the more diffuse the highlights will be. you can control the amount of reflectivity by tweaking with a color swatch. Darker colors reduce the reflections and brighter colors do the opposite. Let's do another quick test render. We can clearly see how the reflections are affecting the scene. The highlighted areas seem too glary at the moment. So let's cancel that. Let's reduce the reflectivity value to about 5 and do another test render. So that's much better now. A lot better. Most users would probably look at this render result and be happy with it. However, we can make this surface even more realistic by making the surface reflect light more unevenly, as seen in real life. We can quickly achieve this by simply applying grayscale bitmaps to the reflections, highlight glossiness, and the reflection glossiness toggles. Let's start by copying and pasting the multi-texture from the diffuse into the reflect toggle. To grayscale the multi-texture, we are going to apply the color correction procedural map to desaturate it. In the replace map dialog, choose to keep the old map as submap. To desaturate all these textures, simply reduce the saturation value to about -100. We can use the brightness and contrast values to control the reflectivity based on a bitmap grayscale. Next, we go into the maps rollout parameters to control the grayscale bitmap. At the moment, V-Ray is using 100% of the grayscale texture to reflect the surroundings. To mix between the reflection color values and the new grayscale bitmap, we're going to reduce the reflect values. Let's do another quick test render. We can make a few more tweaks here and there. For better preview of the reflectivity and the specular for post-production, simply add the specular and the raw reflection render elements. So with this one, we'll actually see how reflections are behaving. So we're going to leave the reflections like that. So the next thing that we're going to do is to copy that into the highlight and glossiness. There. Obviously, we've lost some of it because needs to be tweaked slightly. So let's just do a test render to see how that's going to behave. We can also desaturate the diffuse texture slightly by using the same techniques as before. So the colors are less saturated now. Next, we're going to add a grayscale bitmap to the bump toggle to make the surface more realistic. Let's start by copying the grayscale bitmap from the reflect toggle and pasting it into the bump toggle. We can also tweak the color correction parameters and reduce the bump values to make it more realistic. The next stage is to simply use the render elements to polish it in post. The final result can be seen in this visual produced for a client. Check out my other tutorials in my 3D visuals to see how the render elements can be used in post-production. A sample of this flow exercise and more detailed tutorials are available to my Patreon supporters on my blog and the Udemy page.